There have been tremendous developments in the field of cardiac surgery. Hi, I'm Dr. Randy Martin, and I want you to imagine what it would be like if we were able to assemble some of the world's top cardiac surgeons and cardiologists to discuss the latest developments in the Ross procedure, and you were able to visit with them and learn from them. I appreciate you spending time with us and certainly educating us a lot. One of the questions that I would have is, do we today have good survival data about the Ross procedure?
I think we have. This has been accumulating in the last 5 to 10 years, and there is now compelling evidence that survival advantage is with the Ross operation is a real thing. There has been several studies, regardless of how often they had to reoperate on these patients who had excellent survival. We had the prospective randomized trial, which definitively shows that there is a survival advantage. Now, there is a theoretical reason behind all that.
Right.
So it's starting to fit. Without a shadow of doubt, experience is showing that there is a survival advantage. But to me, what's even more important is the quality of life of the patients. You need to see the patient and come in contact with them to see what the Ross operation means and to patients and obviously to clinicians, because after all, they trust us, the patients do. And we are their advocates, and it is our duty to make it known.
And I think you're exactly right. I mean, it's the there's the misconception in this country, I think, especially among cardiologists that don't spend a lot of time in the valvular world, that a mechanical valve is what you put in a young person because of quotes durability. And I'm not sure the data supports that. Plus, the morbidity of the therapies that go along with that affect the quality of life issue dramatically. So if I came to you and said I'm a young patient, so I'm 25 years of age, and I've read that other valves might last as long, is that a good argument for mechanical valve might last as long, or a homograft might last as long, and I know your study, is that a valid argument?
No, absolutely not, because I would say that living valves have been shown to perform functions way beyond just open and shut. And they influence both the length of survival as well as the quality of life. So I tell you as my patient that this is something which you have to take into consideration seriously.
That's the and that's the theoretical advantage of these, that they're living tissue?
Yeah, absolutely.
And there are no gradients in essence, I mean all
It's not just no gradients, it's the pattern flow. It affects the coronary circulation, it affects left ventricular function, it affects the way the whole circulatory system was designed. It is the sophistications of biology. It is, to some extent, the oversimplification of we can recreate biology. We are starting to edge towards that. But we are very far behind in terms of emulating what biological systems do. And in this case, it's just a screaming example of how biology, when you have a living valve, how it performs so much better in every way, and to my way of thinking, and it's now being validated by the randomized trial, that it translates into clinical benefit. And this needs to be known.
Absolutely needs to be known. What about the not the argument, but just as you and I know that all surgeons are not the same, okay? Some are better technically than others. If I think about the experience in North America, and I was talking with Tyrone about this, is where the valve came up, the operation came up in popularity, and then as he showed, he talked about it, fell off. And the reason being is that we had good surgeons doing one or two and having failures, and it just stopped. Is there the argument, if this is in the right hands an excellent operative choice, and the right patient as well, should we only have the right hands do this procedure? In other words, should we try to have a certain number of locations around the country, around the world? Is this about an operation that every surgeon can learn how to do?
Eventually, yes. But right now, the operation has many small points which needs to be adhered to. It is not magic. It is teachable. People should know about it, but initially it just does need experience to have this attention to detail. Once you have defined that and everybody knows about it, there's no reason why people who are dedicated to that cause, and I totally subscribe to your view that there should be specialized centers, because it is a longer operation. It entails a whole lot of details, and if you do not make sure that you are following all these details, then you start having complications, and it's not forgiving, but it's the very best you can give to your young patient or older patients.
Tell me about the old. The older patient. I mean, how old?
How old? I mean, that. How old is old? I think one major consideration is a survival. Mm-hmm. So you need to extend survival in anybody who has a life expectancy of, I put it, Ron Elkins put that figure a long time ago, of 15 years.
Right.
But much more importantly, I have had people come to me around 68, 69, who really are full of life, and they want to continue to have a great life. And they elected to have this operation, and they have not regretted it. I mean, it just gives a massive improvement in quality of life and survival. So how old is old?
It's in the eye of the beholder, is that right?
It's in the eye of the beholder.
But, you know, it's interesting that you say that, because, and I would agree with you, but in this country, and maybe in Europe as well, that patient would come in asking for a TAVI, would be coming in, or everybody would be talking to him. That's, you know, where we have no data. I mean, certainly these look very promising, but we have no data. But it's the concept, maybe it's only an American concept, it's the concept that I want no scar, I want minimally invasive this or that. So if a 68-year-old robust guy comes into you and mentally sharp, and he says, I've heard about having these valves put in without any operation versus this Ross procedure, what would you tell him?
I would tell him it depends what you want. These valves which are being put transcranial will eventually be perfected to some extent. I mean, but we are nowhere near there, and they are currently being used as a stopgap. And for somebody like yourself, there is no doubt that these two things are completely different.
Right.
They are not alternatives in any way or form. So if you want to be experimenting, and we know that these valves are not living, maybe At one stage, we will have tissue engineered living valves, but we're nowhere near that target. We are working very hard towards that, but we're not there. And to subject a patient at that stage to a TAVI, when you could be giving him a far superior operation in terms of guaranteeing longevity and quality of life, there is no way I would recommend that or even think that it is a possibility.
I had a chance to visit with Hans, obviously, and Tyrone, and they both were talking, and you obviously have talked about this, is that if you have the expert surgeon who's experienced, part of that experience is knowing the right patient to do this on. Correct? I mean, it has to
correct.
Be. What
correct.
Does the pulmonary leaflets look like? What do the aortic sinuses look like? So that it's not, I mean, it's not only technical expertise, but it's also selection expertise and knowing when not to do it. Isn't that correct?
That is correct, but in the randomized trial we have performed, we liberalized the indications to a certain extent. Yes, it had to be a single valve disease. Yes, we only applied it to patients who did not have coronary artery disease mm-hmm. or renal failure or multisystem disease. But my God, there are so many patients who would fulfill these data.
Right.
So the application, there are thousands of patients who require aortic valve replacement who would satisfy the criteria for having a ROS operation.
It's, you know, and I come back to the, and I've got some more questions, but you're stimulating me here. It's not even on the horizon of patients, much less many of the, or cardiologists, much less patients in this country, except for a limited few. How do we, and I've learned an immense amount listening to you and your colleagues, how do we get this message out? I mean, obviously scientific studies tell us something, and your studies and other studies tell us about survivorship, freedom from reoperation, all that, but how do we get that message out to the cardiologist today?
I think by having meetings like this one, putting information on the internet,
absolutely.
And patients really do read things and look. I have had several patients who would come specifically asking for this operation and seem to know a lot about the exercise capacity. The way they want to have this type of life following an operation like the ROS operation. So it's just a matter of information.
I think you're 100% right. Unfortunately, not for scholarly people like yourself, but in this country, people have limited attention spans. And so you have to organize the information and present it in the right way, so then they'll, I'm speaking about the cardiologist, and then they'll delve into it in a deeper way. I think there's tremendous power, and now you're beginning to get longevity data. Your studies and others have shown that. And there's tremendous power in sort of organizing that data right for both the patients and the physicians. And then I think you'd see, at least in this country, you might see it rise up. Oftentimes, the internet's used as a marketing tool for a single physician or a single site. So maybe a valve foundation, maybe a valve information that I'm going long here, I don't mean to, but there's an interesting thing that's happened in the PFO world that a bunch of patients who are knowledgeable patients have formed something called the PFO Foundation to get adequate information out about what it really is and all that. So I think that's a great
possibility.
Advance. What happens if the pulmonary autograft starts to fail? Is it retrievable?
Two points here. One is that there are ways and means of making a failure extremely rare, like in our series, 1 to 2% over a period of 12 to 15 years. That is really acceptable. It is a very, to me, that's a very small price to pay for a better life.
Absolutely.
And a longer life.
Absolutely.
Attention to detail to make sure that the failure rate is going to be very low. And then we really have to continue to look at the mechanisms of failure at a much deeper level, at molecular and cellular, and get into the personalized medicine and see the interaction between the valve, the type of valve, and the patient himself,
right,
with his genetic background. We're not there yet. We've written a News and Views for Nature Reviews, talking a bit about that and saying, entitled, the article was entitled, The Private Life of Tissue Valves, because I think it's a very intimate relationship between a tissue valve and individual.
And the Russell individual.
And the Russell individual would be something similar. But the mere fact, the fact is that we have shown that it is applicable to a very large number of people, and that needs to be known.
What about, and I would agree with you wholeheartedly, and I love the title of your review, what about the congenitally malformed valve? Tyrone has, you know, has made the point that if you've got something wrong with the leaflets, or you've got a big annulus, are there people with, quotes, bicuspid valves that this should not be done on?
I think we're still learning in that area. And there are some people with a dilated annulus who have a bicuspid valve, but right now we can tailor the annulus by, in our case, what we call intertrigonal plication compression, which can be remedied. And we just have to continue to look at things in the longer term. And in the meantime, be looking at all the genetic mutations which could contribute to dilatation, because there is a massive amount of knowledge which is accumulating very rapidly into the mechanisms of thoracic aortic aneurysms.
Right, right.
And that's applicable
very much so
to the Ross operation.
Well, it's very interesting, because I think you're exactly right, is that, you know, I used to see in the echo world, commonly would see people who'd had an AVR for a bicuspid aortic valve, and they'd come back, the valve might be a tissue valve, might be a mechanical valve, they'd come back and the valve was okay, but their aorta was
dilating
gigantically. And so I think it's something we didn't, you know, surgeons didn't know, and certainly the cardiologists had no idea about that. So you're right that we're beginning to get knowledge, and maybe that genetic knowledge will help us figure out, you know, which patient to do what on, and especially the Ross procedure. Is there a contraindication for Ross in rheumatic disease?
We think not, and we apply this operation in Africa, because I have a charity where we go to Africa very frequently, and we perform this operation on young people with rheumatic heart disease. The important thing is that they must adhere to secondary prevention, because that is not 100%, but it's quite effective in stopping acute rheumatic endocarditis. And there is a fair amount of research on the molecular targets of the autoimmune system in rheumatic heart disease. So hopefully that either an antibody or a vaccine will be developed. But in the meantime, the Ross operation is quite effective in rheumatic heart disease. Where it is absolutely contraindicated is in rheumatoid arthritis. That, because I have seen it, you have inflammation of the root, which creeps on onto the living pulmonary autograft. And to my way of thinking, that's completely.
How about ankylosing spondylitis, same thing? Any kind of aortitis?
Any kind of aortitis, Reiter's syndrome,
right.
Rheumatoid arthritis, it's just not on.
That's very interesting. So it's a disease of those tissues. What we had an interesting discussion, as I alluded to. I mean, I've not had extensive experience in following Ross's with echo, although I've seen some. Most of the complications I've seen have been on the pulmonary homograph, and interesting listening to Professor DaCosta. What's your thinking on that? Is preoperatively, so you're getting ready to do a Ross procedure on somebody. John Brown makes the case for oversizing and non-steroidals, decellularization. Where do we stand with that on the right side?
We've conducted a study very early on, must be like 15 years ago, and we came to exactly the same conclusions. That we can put a pulmonary homograft in the right ventricular outflow in an infant of a large adult size. So we put 2.6, 2.7 in a baby. And that guarantees wide open homograft. And again, like what you were talking about, the inflammatory process, we found the pulmonary stenosis occurs only early and then stabilizes. And when we looked at it with the MRI, we found that a large percentage of them were like a tube stenosis.
Absolutely.
With compression from outside. And that was validated when we went in to put a valve in. We found massive amount of chronic inflammatory reaction around the homograft, and not affecting the homograft itself. So that's the idea of using anti-inflammatory, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory came at that point. Also, we saw that there was stenosis at the top suture line, never at the bottom suture line. And that's why we started to do interrupted sutures and that.
If you have a patient, so let me now come to you as a consultative physician. If you have a patient who has that, so he's got a 60, 70 millimeter gradient across the tubular stenosis of the pulmonary homograph, what do we do? Do we, because in the United States, everybody would start thinking, let's stent this. And there was a lot of talk about stenting. And stent, or do you reoperate on somebody like that?
We found that stenting is not very effective because A, it recurs, and B, it renders the valve incompetent, because with the tubular stenosis, there is no way you can put a stent in without destroying valve function. Putting a TAVI is not great either, because there are small valves.
Right.
So what I do is do not rush at these patients, even if they have a gradient, not a peak gradient of 60, it doesn't worry me. I look at mean gradients, and I'm sure that's what you do. The next thing is we do MRI and see how thick, how much right ventricular hypertrophy there is. How much right ventricular dysfunction there is, if there is any dysfunction which is continuing, or severe hypertrophy, or limitation in exercise capacity. These would be indications for reoperation, and never just the gradient.
Excellent.
I don't operate on gradient.
I would agree with you wholeheartedly. That's an interesting way to think about it, because you're really looking at the effect it has on the end organ, on the right ventricle, and their symptoms. And I think that's a very wise, you know, their risk of sudden death or their risk of something is very minimal with this. I mean,
absolutely. We got worried early in our experience that we had one patient who, following a successful ROS operation, was swimming 8 months after operation and suddenly died. It was a sudden death. Mm. We looked at the valve and it was just looked perfect. And the point with that particular patient, it was the third operation. The left ventricle was already badly fibrosed, right, and hypertrophied. It was regressing. But timing of application of this operation, and you were talking about that,
right,
and Bob Bono talked about when, right, Dr. Carabello is not to allow the patients to progress and have left ventricular disease, which will predispose to sudden death. The operation itself does not predispose to sudden death. And we have documented that early on, in that we were worried about the fact that the excision of the pulmonary valve would either impair right ventricular function or produce arrhythmias.
Arrhythmias, yeah.
And neither of these things we could document at all. We found some impairment of right ventricular function, especially the longitudinal function by echo, but when we had controls in patients who did not have the ROS operation, following just any type of bypass operation, they were completely comparable.
Absolutely. I mean, it's very common for me to see the right ventricle come back from surgery not being happy.
Mm-hmm.
And so you couldn't say it was the ROS procedure. I mean, if nothing's done on the right side, they still come back not happy. And hopefully in this country, at least, the surgeons are beginning to pay attention to a lot of RV preservation things, which are very, very important. Is there, so if I have a problem, so what you're telling me is that really preoperative knowledge by the surgeon and technique can prevent a lot of the postoperative, quotes, complications, or minimize them.
Absolutely.
That's the argument that a cardiologist will say, well, you're doing two operations. A surgeon tells me it's a long operation. It's got to be bad on the heart.
Exactly. And he will find something in the literature that there is a linear correlation between survival and bypass
time. Pump time, yeah. And you're saying that techniques have shown, not techniques on how to do it, but your data has shown that's not the case.
Yeah. And people like Jerry Buckberg, if he hasn't contributed anything else, I don't agree with everything he says, but my God, his contribution of introducing cold blood cardioplegia has been just like a revolution.
Yes, sir.
It just made cross clamp time irrelevant.
Coming to sort of your excellent views and your knowledge, what patient would you consider would be the best candidate, or where the ROS would be the best option for the patient or patients? What are the ideal patients?
I think all children below the age of 16 or 18 are candidate for the ROS operation, without a shadow of doubt. And I don't think many people would disagree about that. It is the group between 16 or 18 and 69,
right,
where everybody's arguing about. My own, I'm going to say bias, but it's really backed by some
science.
Data. All of these patients will benefit from a ROS operation. Having said that, because of the living valve theory,
mm-hmm,
it was interesting that the issue of the Lancet, which published our randomized trial,
right,
only in the UK, because they put relevant studies, they put on the front page a statement which will affect practice. And the statement was insertion of a living valve, the theory of insertion of a living valve and its influence on survivor and quality of life has been validated by our study.
That's great.
Yeah,
that's,
and they put it on the front that's because, and I think that's it will come more and more, which proves that biology is supreme and it translates into clinical benefit. So the answer to your questions, this group of patients should be treated by the ROS operation. One point about our study, which could be interpreted as a weakness, is that we compared to homografts, and not everybody says that uses homograft. So we really need to validate our findings by comparing it to other commonly used valves in that age group, including prosthetic valves, I regret to say, as well as unstented valves.
Right.
And some of our colleagues, we've been thinking a lot about that in designing what we call the RAMSES trial. And RAMSES stands for randomized aortic, randomized autograft
right.
replacement of the aortic valve versus mechanical or unstented valves, because I think these are the three which people could consider. The problem is, like we have heard, is that there are difficulties because everybody has to do exactly the same operation. Yeah. And in a multi-center trial like that, we could visit each other and work together on assisting each other, making absolutely sure that the operation we're doing is standard. But then some people will object, like myself, using a prosthetic valve in a young patient, while others think it is the best thing. So I'm told by epidemiologists and statisticians that it's perfectly all right to have 2x2 trial and randomize to 2 for people who prefer to do that right. and are experts at it. And others, like myself, would prefer to use ROS versus unstented, and somebody else would use unstented versus prosthetic valves.
Right, right.
And then we can lump the data and get some meaningful data. But my theory is autografts, ROSs are going to be superior again.
Is that trial going to be ongoing?
It hasn't started yet, but it is in the embryonic state. We're going to register it and hopefully start. There are several people like John Brown
right.
and others who are enthusiastic about the idea.
You have certainly convinced me through the science, obviously, and the colleagues have, of that this is a really valuable alternative for patients from longevity, quality of life, living tissue. How do we get that word out? How do we make sure that patients that might benefit from the ROS have it available to them?
I think by spreading the information and then establishing large centers with dedicated people, both cardiologists and cardiac surgeons and everybody else, who really are convinced and know how to do this operation and offer that service to the public. And that should be fantastic.
Thank you very much for all your many contributions, but especially for visiting with us. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
So I've had the opportunity now to visit with the world's experts, and it's given me a whole new perspective on the Ross procedure. What have I learned? I've learned that in excellent hands, and that really is the key, that you have excellent surgeons doing the operation, selecting candidates the right way, that this is a great operation because it offers durability and it offers something that we don't think about too often, which is really quality of life issues. I think in the United States, this really needs to be on the horizon of both the surgeon and the cardiologist and the patient. And it's probably going to require that we educate ourselves first, the patients in a secondary fashion, but make the patients be joint in their shared decision. And it's going to require, I think, that we have expertise in selecting the right patient. That means cardiologists have to get actively involved in this. And then tremendous expertise in having the right surgeons do this initially. Is it a trainable technique? Yes, it is. But I think we're going to have centers where this is done. But it, I am totally convinced now, sitting here looking at the data and listening to the colleagues and having a chance to visit with them, that this is a tremendous operation when done well, and it offers patients a tremendous quality of life.